6:33. But the main thing today is that what we need to see is that all around the world, things are happening. And especially even here in the United States, we see the same things happening, even with sickness and disease and with medical programs and different things. And the Bible even says to put no trust in a brother, basically because people will always let you down. Well, organizations and entities that are given the task of protecting you and taking care of you, they are made up of people who will also let you down. And so our only source of hope is Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father. He is our only source of true hope. Now, in saying that, I want to say that there's a lot that you can do. There's a lot of normal things. You know, people say, well, you know, how much do you trust God? How do you trust God? You know, if you really trust, if you look both ways before you cross the street, are you not trusting God? No, we're not talking about silly things like that, right? There's a certain amount of awareness that it goes on around you, that you're aware of the things that are happening around you. But what I'm talking about is that there comes a point where your protection has to be divine. And the only true protection is divine. Amen. And so you can do a lot of things, even as far as health goes. You can eat right, exercise, get rest, do all the things that everybody says you have to do, and yet still contract some type of disease or illness or just drop dead jogging. I mean, there's all kinds of things that can happen. So your faith cannot be in nutrition. Your faith cannot be in exercise. It can't be in natural things. Now, I'm not saying, well, even the Bible says that bodily exercise profits little. It doesn't say it doesn't profit at all. It profits little, and some of us need a little profiting, okay? So, not against that, okay? But the Bible is very clear that our only protection, our only source of help comes from above, and that it is our Heavenly Father. So Christianity was supernatural from the beginning. It started with a supernatural birth of Jesus, culminated with a supernatural resurrection from out of the dead. And actually that's what launched us into who and what we are today, is because of that resurrection from the dead. So we want to talk about becoming untouchable. As we go on in this world and as things happen, as systems fail and fail people, then they're going to have to either be able to rely on God themselves, or they're going to have to know people that can rely on God for them. Amen. I always tell people, you're either going to be praying for people or somebody's going to be praying for you, right? And you're either going to be doing these things or you're going to be going to someone who does these things for help. So pretty much it's your decision. Now, over the next few months, and I didn't make in the announcement, but Wednesday nights are our life team nights, and it's more of a training type. Everything I do is training to some degree. But we are specifically going to be targeting areas of training in our life teams. And especially throughout the rest of this year, but especially beginning the first of next year, it is going to be a specific training on purpose, very systematic, and we're going to see to it that you as believers grow up into Christ Jesus in all things, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4. So I do believe God has given us a plan for that, so we're following that. And but we want to be talking today about becoming untouchable. There should be a place, and as I will show you examples, where you live, not where you visit from time to time, but where you live, where the enemy cannot touch you. Amen. All right? It does no, well, that's some good, I guess, but it's not good enough to believe in healing. Get sick, get healed. Get sick, get healed. Get sick, get healed. We have to believe in divine health. We have to believe in divine protection so that if you are sick, you can be healed and live healed the rest of your life. Amen. Amen? And at the end of your life, you shouldn't go out of here sick and with tubes and all that kind of stuff. You ought to go out of here with a voice of victory. You ought to go out of here praising God. Amen. And, you know, as I've told people before, I have spent, you know, a good part of my life now defeating sickness and disease, especially in other people. I've really not had to battle too much in my own life, but I think it's mainly because I sow so much into other people's lives that it's that reaping that just, I live in divine health. And so in that, I I've done that most of my life now, or a good part of my life. And so I do not believe that at the end of my life that something that I have beaten for years and years should have the upper hand and be the thing that takes me out. Amen. And that would usher me into the very tangible presence of the living God. I believe that we ought to go out of here like the saints of old, gather our loved ones around, be ready to go, live to a ripe old age to where we are satisfied with long life, and then we're ready to commit ourselves and our spirit unto God. And at that point, we bless our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, and we're able to bless them and then say goodbye and let them watch how a saint of God should leave this world if they're going to leave. Amen? Amen. And so we need to learn to live in victory all the time. Amen. Now, that's not beyond, and you got to understand, this is not beyond what the Bible says. This is exactly what the Bible says, and I will prove it to you, right? So first, if you have your Bibles, we're going to go to a couple of scriptures. I'm going to read them fairly quickly because I want to get through all of this today. But in Luke chapter 4, and you know this situation, Jesus is going into his hometown to preach. So in Luke chapter 4, verse 15. Now verse 15, if you're going to break up chapters, that's where you would break it up, technically. Because he's in another place preaching, and then he goes to his own hometown in verse 16. And so we're going to start in verse 15, and I want you to notice the attitude of the people that he's preaching to in verse 15. Luke 4:15, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all. Hear that? So he was going around teaching in their synagogues, and as he taught in their synagogues, all of the people glorified him, lifted him up, gave him praise, and said, wow, what words. And I can prove that because they said that later on at the same time. But they glorified him for what he was preaching. And they started lifting him up and exalting him in that sense and saying, who has ever heard a man talk like this? Who says these things? And then he shows up in his hometown. When he shows up in his hometown, verse 16, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, so see, now this was not his first sermon, right? This was normal. This was in the course, okay? So he didn't start at home. He started somewhere else. That's a good note. A lot of times, it's better to start somewhere else than your own home, right? In your own hometown is what I'm talking about. You'll see why. As his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Verse 17, and there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. Notice he didn't just open it, close his eyes, and put his finger and start reading. Right? He found the place. He was looking for the particular scripture. Now, they didn't have chapter and verse. He had to know the book of Isaiah. He had it memorized. He knew where it was at, and he found the place where it was written. And here's what he started reading. And this is out of Isaiah chapter 61, actually. Verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Now, you got to understand, he's not just reading this out. He's reading it, but you'll see in just a minute, he's saying, this is true today. So not only was he saying it, not only was he reading it, he was proclaiming it, right? So imagine, you got 400 years with no prophet, then you got John the Baptist showing up and preaching out in the wilderness. A lot of controversy over him. The religious people didn't like him, but the people that loved God did. Notice the two differences. And then Jesus shows up, and the first thing that Jesus is preaching is the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So he was proclaiming himself to be a prophet in their minds. That's what they were thinking, because only prophets said those kind of things. And he said, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Notice the first thing he said, preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. Verse 19, to preach, proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, notice it says verse 20, and he closed the book. So he reads the verse 20 here, he reads out of Isaiah 61. When he gets to that part where he says, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, he closes the book. Now, if he had read the next verse out of Isaiah, it talks about also proclaiming the day of God's wrath. But notice he stopped at preaching the acceptable year of the Lord. Why? Because he had come to preach the gospel. And anyone that received it, understood that they were accepted of the Lord. And those that didn't, well, that comes later. But notice the wrath here in Isaiah 61 is a later event, not today. You got to get that. God is not pouring out his wrath today. AIDS is not God's wrath on the homosexual. You got that? Sickness and disease and these things, all these things, they are not God's wrath on the people. God's wrath was poured out on Jesus, and there will come a time that anyone not in him will also receive that wrath.
Amen.
Okay? So now is the time to get into that name, get into him. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, a fortress, it says, and to get into it. But why? To avoid the wrath that is to come. That's what John the Baptist told the Pharisees when they came out. He said, who has warned you to try to evade or to flee from the wrath to come? Right? So it wasn't yet. Now, and he closed the book and he gave it again to the minister and he sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. So now he just stands up, says all this, and then shuts the book and sits down. And you can imagine it was quiet. You could probably heard a pin drop because everybody's thinking, what was that? Because he just claimed all of that by just reading this. And he, now notice the word here, and he began to say, what does that mean? It means he didn't get to finish what he was saying. He began to say, and somebody interrupted him right in the middle of it. And he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? Isn't this, who is he that he would claim this? Isn't this Joseph's son? And he said unto them, you will surely say unto me this proverb, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your country. And he said, verily, absolutely, without a doubt, I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. That's why most of the time when you're going to get started, you have to go somewhere else from where you live. Almost all the people called of God end up leaving where they started and going somewhere else. Abraham did it. Moses did it. Almost every one of them. Verse 25, but I tell you of a truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine was throughout all the land. But unto none of them was Elias sent, except unto Sarepta, a city of Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow. Now, why did he tell where she was from? Because he was pointing out she was not Israelite, and yet God sent a prophet to her. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elias the prophet, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. Might as well say Naaman the non-Israelite. In other words, there's a whole bunch of lepers in Israel, but none of them got healed, but it was somebody outside the camp, outside Israel, that got healed. Now watch verse 28. And all they in the synagogue, all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Now, these are the same people that were wondering at the gracious words that came out of his mouth. So, the atmosphere of a room can change in a second. Okay? As soon as you say something that the people don't agree with, people don't like, everything can change. But if you're going to preach the Word of God, you're going to say what it says, regardless of whether the people are going to receive it or not. So, notice here, they were all filled with wrath. Now watch, and they rose up. Now this is a whole synagogue. Now, I have had people leave meetings. I've been places where they've never invited me back. But I have never yet been in a place where they all rose up, grabbed a hold of me, and took me outside to throw me off a cliff. Okay? But that's what happens to him in verse 29. They rose up and thrust him out of the city. Now thrust him out. Now that's pushing him, going on, deriding him, saying things to him. It wasn't a fun time. And they led him unto the brow of the hill whereon their city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. And so they're going to take him out, pick him. Now get that. They're not going to push him off the cliff. They're going to pick him up, turn him upside down, and throw him off the cliff. Right? Now, notice here, Jesus, and I love verse 30, but Jesus goes along with them. They leave the city. They're all walking with him. They're pushing him, talking to him. They're taking him out. They're leading him. So they probably got a hold of his arm, and they're walking out. He knows how he's going to die. He knows he has an appointment with a cross, not with a cliff. Amen. You got that? And so they're leading him out, and he's going along with him. And I can just picture him walking because he knows what the outcome is going to be. And he's walking with them, and as he walks out with them, they're grabbing him and they're talking. There's no telling, we're going to throw you over the cliff. You're a false prophet. No telling what all they said. And I can see him walking right to that edge, and he's just going along with them, going, you're really going to do this? You're sure? You sure you want this recorded in heaven against you? You sure? Yeah, I mean, we're getting close to the cliff. You still got some time to change your mind, but once we get there, it's good as done. You know that's what he was thinking. And then it says, when they brought him out to that cliff, now watch, verse 30. But he, passing through the midst of them, went his way. So here he is walking along. They've got him by the arms. They're leading him out. They're saying all this stuff. They're going to throw him off the cliff. I mean, the same people that stone people, they're going to throw him off the cliff. So this wasn't a far stretch. And they're taking him out. He gets to the edge. He goes, okay, this is it. And just turns and walks away. Now think about that. How could he just turn and walk away? Except there's only two explanations for this. Number one, he had the power of God in his life, which we know to be the case. The only other explanation was he had mastered the Jedi mind tricks. That's the only two things. This is not the prophet you're looking for. You know, it's just, no, I don't know. But he just walked through the midst of them, turned around and just walked out. I mean, think about that. And they're all standing there, and this crowd is riled up pretty good. They're going to throw him off the cliff. They're mad. They don't like what he said. Now, notice what got them mad is whenever he said, just because you're in Israel doesn't make you special. God looks at people that have faith, not at people who have a name. And he even told the Jews, he said, this kingdom is going to be taken from you and given to another people, which are no people. And he was talking about to the Gentiles at that point. Now think about that. And the bad part is now the Gentiles have become just like the Jews in Jesus' day and think, I'm in, I'm good. That's it. Can't do nothing about it. Can't take the kingdom away from me. Let me tell you, God can do what he wants to do. Right? And with that kind of attitude, what makes you think you're in the kingdom anyway? Just saying. Anyway, let's move on. See, that's why we build this on a flat land. See, we ain't nowhere near a cliff. Okay. Now, watch what he says in verse 31. And he came down to Capernaum. So now he just left. But he had just said, surely you're going to say this to me. Do the things here that were done in Capernaum. And here it says, and he came down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and taught them on the Sabbath days. Now watch how they received him. Verse 32. And they were astonished at his doctrine, at his teaching. Why? For his word was with power. That word power there is number 1849 in Strong's Concordance. It's the Greek word exousia, and it means authority. His word was with authority. He spoke as one that had authority, which is why everybody said he's not like the scribes and the Pharisees. He doesn't talk about this commentary, that commentary, or what this person says, or this, or that rabbi. He just says it like he knows what he's talking about. And so, now notice, this is Jesus was totally protected against an angry mob that was going to kill him. So that's divine protection. Amen? All right, let's go to the next one. In John chapter 18, starting in verse 3, this is when Jesus was arrested. You say, well, wait, he was arrested and crucified. Doesn't sound like protection. Hang on. Okay. Because first off, he said, no man takes my life, I lay it down, and I pick it back up. No man takes my life from me. So what he did of his own choice. But in John chapter 18, verse 3, it starts and says, Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, come thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Now you know where they were going. They were going into the garden to arrest Jesus. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, Whom seek ye? And they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus saith unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. And as soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backwards and fell to the ground. You hear that? So here's all these soldiers. They come up. They got all these officers and soldiers, and everybody's coming. They have weapons, torches, lantern, all this stuff, and they're going to arrest him. They're all going after one man who has caused no trouble at all. They send an entire, SWAT team, right, in to capture him. He's done nothing. They send him in the middle of the night, and they start to take him, and as soon as he says, who are you looking for? Oh, we're looking for Jesus. And he says, I'm he. Bam, they all fall down. The power of God knocked them to the ground. And people say, well, I don't believe in that falling out stuff and being slain in the spirit. Well, here's a good example, but not necessarily the one you want, right? You find more times than not, the people that fell in the Bible were enemies of God, not the friends of God. Not saying it didn't happen to God's friends too, right? But they all fell backwards. And imagine this. Here they fell backwards, and then they get up, and they're still going to arrest him. So they know he's got power because the power of God, as he spoke, knocked them down, and yet they are so intent. This shows how far the human mind can be constricted by religious thought and even in Christians, there can be a miracle happen right in front of people, and people go, and then 15 minutes out there, well, I wonder if they were really crippled. I wonder if they... I was traveling years ago, and I had a young man that traveled. He was a young man then. That was traveling with me. We went in, and I've probably told you this story, but we went in and had some amazing meetings. And there was a young girl there in a wheelchair, had never walked since she was a child, had a spinal bifida, and had never walked and been prayed for and all kinds of stuff. And she came out of that wheelchair while we were in those meetings. And people watched her walk back and forth, watched her push her wheelchair out. The whole crowd there was just amazed. It got so quiet when she got it was so quiet. And then it erupted. It's like people were in shock. And then when they finally saw it and realized, wait, she is actually walking, everybody just went wild. And that was just one of the more notable miracles. There were all kinds of other things that happened. But when we got I was driving a Tahoe at that point. When we got back in the Tahoe to come back, we get about, 30 minutes down the road. And this guy that was riding with me had been there when I prayed for that girl, watched her guide it. He was standing right there on the other side of the chair. And he said, he was sitting there shaking his head, and he just started asking, Curry, I just want to see the power of God. When are we going to see the power of God? When are we really going to see the power? And I looked at him and I said, where were you last night? I said, you were on the other side of that chair. You saw the girl get out of the wheelchair. Yeah, but I just want to see the power of God. And I pulled off the side of the road. And I told him, I said, get out. And he looked at me, and I said, yeah, I know we're in Michigan. And he said, well, how am I going to get home? I said, I don't care. I said, all I know is I'm not riding back from here to Texas listening to you full of doubt and put doubt out when we watched a girl that had never walked get out of a wheelchair. And I said, your problem right now is you're just religious. And he got real quiet. And I said, now, did she walk or did she not? Yep, she walked. Okay, you can get back in. And then we came on back home. And it was real quiet most of the trip. But I will tell you, I'd rather it be quiet than listen to somebody talk doubt and unbelief. Amen? So, here, they fought. You think about this. It shows how these people were. We look at these people in the Bible and think they were so special. But you look at some of them and they were so dense. It was amazing how dense they could be. And even in the Old Testament. Here you got a prophet that's telling Israel everything that this enemy king does. And the enemy king says, hey, we got a spy in the camp. Because, everywhere I go, this Israelite king knows where I'm going and beats us. And they said, oh, no, it's not a spy. It is a prophet in Israel that tells them everything you do. And then he says, okay, well, we got to capture that prophet. you think he doesn't know you're coming? I mean, he already knows everything you're doing, and you're going to sneak up on him and capture him? I don't think so, right? So if you hear where he's at and you go there and he's there, then that should really scare you, because he knew you were coming and ain't worried about it. I mean, think about that. Then that's kind of like, I think we just walked into a trap. You know, so it just shows how dense people can be. So let's get back in the scripture. He says here, and then ask him, yeah, verse 7, then ask ye them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Now, you know the second time they said that, they said, Jesus of Nazareth. You know, waiting to get knocked down, bracing so they're not getting knocked down. You speak, you tell them who we're looking for. See if you fall. See, you got to realize, these people were real people. You know what I mean? They had the same kind of emotions and stuff that we go through. He said, Jesus answered, I've told you that I'm he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which he spoke, of them which thou gavest me have I lost none. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it, smote the high priest's servant, cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Then said Jesus unto Peter, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? And as I've said before, you know that Peter was not aiming for the ear, right? He was aiming right in the middle of the skull, and Malchus moved, right? And he got the ear. Then the band and the captain and the officers of the Jews took Jesus and bound him. Now let's go to John chapter 19. John chapter 19, verse 10. So do you see the protection? Jesus went with them because he wanted to. They fell down. He could have walked through their midst too. If he could walk through the midst of a crowd off of a cliff, you know, back from a cliff, and hear these soldiers all fall down when he speaks, do you think that he wasn't walking in some type of protection here? He had to actually open himself up on purpose to allow himself to be taken. You got that? Think about this. Now remember, the only example of how you're supposed to live in the Bible is Jesus. Not Paul, not Peter, none of those, but Jesus is our example, because it's only Jesus that we're going to be conformed to his image. You got that? So remember that. Now, look at John chapter 19, verse 10. Then saith Pilate, this is when Jesus is standing before Pilate. Then saith Pilate unto him, speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify thee and have power to release thee? In other words, he's telling Jesus, talk to me. You're not going to answer my questions. Don't you realize I can have you killed or I can set you free? It's all in my hand. It's my decision. Jesus answered, you could have no authority at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee has the greater sin. But now notice, he said, here, Pilate, Jesus is standing there bound. Here's the procurator that is the head of the Roman Empire, represents the Roman Empire, and he's questioning me, and Jesus says, you would have no power over me at all if it wasn't given from above. In other words, if God didn't want me doing this, I wouldn't be here right now. The only reason I'm here right now is because this is the cup that I'm supposed to drink. And if it wasn't for that, and you remember one time, he said, don't you know? Well, he starts to watch it. Let's go on. He said, don't you know that if I need it, that the Father could send 12 legions of angels? Amen. Think about that. In other words, they're at my beck and call. They're just waiting. They're just waiting for me to give the call. But yet he said, he opened not his mouth. Why? Sometimes it's good not to open your mouth. Right? Listen, he could not speak anything but freedom. If he had spoke anything, it would have set him free. And so instead, he has to keep his mouth shut, and he goes to be crucified because that was God's plan for him, right? Look at Acts chapter 5. You say, well, you know, Curry, that's pretty good. That's Jesus. So, you know, I'm not like Jesus. Maybe someday, but not now. All right, well, let's go on a little bit further. Go to Acts chapter 5 in verse 12. And by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. And of the rest, durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them.
talking about the apostles, and believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes, both of men and women. Why? Because of the signs and wonders that were being done. But it's still talking about the apostles. Insomuch, verse 15, that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. Verse 16, there came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folk and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one. Everyone. Well, you know, only Jesus could heal them all. Nope. Everyone got healed under the apostles' ministry also, and they were just believers. Right? Believers with a responsibility, believers that accepted a responsibility, but believers. And here every one of them were healed. Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. And they laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors. Notice they opened, the angel opened the prison doors, and brought them forth and said, so now the angel of the Lord's talking to them. Now, you got to get the picture. They were preaching. They were doing these miracles. Then the religious people got mad, had them arrested, put them into prison. An angel shows up, says, here, I'm letting you out. Now, I want you to go and stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. So he's telling them, where I just brought you from, I want you to go back there and preach. I'm getting you out of prison so you can go preach to the people who just put you in prison. You get that? Now, you know they had to be thinking, what? Okay, but is this going to be like a revolving door? Every day we're going to get arrested. We're going to come in. We're going to go to sleep. You're going to wake us up, and then you're going to lead us out, and then we're going to get arrested again because we're going to go back and preach. Is this going to be how it goes? But at this point, they listen, and they go back. But the point I want to get across is this. Notice the angel didn't stop them from getting arrested. They were in the prison. But the doors opened. An angel opened the doors of the prison and let them out. So just because you think, well, you know, protection's good, but once I'm not protected, well, now I'm not protected. No, you can still be released. You understand? So you don't stop and go, well, I guess this is what it's supposed to be. No, it was not God's plan for Peter to be tried, to go to prison, to do all these things. You understand that? That wasn't his plan. So the angel of the Lord opens the door and lets him back out. So at whatever stage of persecution or problems you're in, there is always an answer. It's never too late. You get that? Never too late. Whether it's sickness, disease, anything, whether it's persecution, whether it's being put in prison, whether it's whatever it is, it's never too late. The key is you keep your faith applied. You keep your faith going. You keep your faith in God. You keep saying, I will come out of this. I will come through this. I told you about whenever I was way back, and there was sin in my life, and I remember I was so far from God. And yet at the same time, I would tell God, don't forget me. Don't forget me. You know I'm not going to be like this forever. You know I'm coming out of this. You know I can't live like this the rest of my life. You know I got to come out of this, and you know I'm coming out, so don't forget me. I remember telling God that just many times as I went on, and eventually did. All right? Didn't take too long, okay? But it was seemed like forever at the time. 20, go stand and speak in the temple to all the people the words of this life. All right, so now we've got Jesus being protected. We've got the apostles being protected, right, in the midst of it. Now go with me to Philippians 1. Philippians 1, verse 19. In verse 19 it says, this is the apostle Paul, just trying to lay some groundwork here. And remember, I'm getting closer to you step by step. Okay. Paul says, for I know that this, talking about him being in prison, him being jailed, that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer. You hear that? Through the prayers of the saints, Paul's situation turned to his deliverance. And, now watch this, through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Verse 20, according to my earnest expectation and my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed. In other words, my faith in God is not in vain. I'm not going to be ashamed in this. This is going to turn from my betterment. You watch how it ends up.
But with that with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. And you think, oh, Paul, see now you just messed up your confession. You just now said that you might die. And he said, well, regardless of whether I live or die, I am going to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, now, what? No, how can you magnify the Lord Jesus Christ by dying? Well, first off, it's not just by dying. Because you could be, as Paul, you could be in prison, and you could be, as many prisoners are or were back in that day, as they were taken out to be killed, they would scream, cry, fight against their captors and try to escape and, you know, just break down and have to be drugged to the place of execution. But if Jesus was going to be magnified, then that means Paul's going to walk out of that prison and say, you don't need to chain me. You don't need to leave me. Just show me where I'm supposed to go. I'll go there. Why? Because I will gladly lay down my life for Jesus Christ. Amen. And matter of fact, I'll pray for you. And if you're sick, anything before, now's your last chance. Because I will lay hands on you. I'll pray for you. I'll minister to you. Even as they were taking him out, you know, to be killed, you go out with dignity. You go out exalting Jesus, showing the peace of God, even in the face of certain death. You go out and you face it in a way that exalts Jesus and magnifies him. And as you've probably heard the stories, if you've read any of Fox's Book of Martyrs, many, many stories of how they were doing. One person was actually being burnt, was going to be burnt alive. And they said, well, listen, if the grace of God is enough while you're being burnt, then just hold up one finger and let us know that the grace of God is with you in the middle of being burned alive. And as they watched, his body was set on fire. And as they watched him burn, they watched because his hands were, and they watched him put up two fingers. Wow. Why? Because the grace of God was more than enough to take care of the situation they were in, even though he was dying by being burned alive. We can look at Stephen, how he was stoned in the midst of it, looking up to heaven. And so there is a way to go out that can magnify God. Going out, crying, whimpering, begging, that's not the way to go out. Yeah. Amen? That doesn't magnify Jesus. Let's show the world that we also believe, not just in the here and now, but in the hereafter. Let's show that we believe that stepping across in the next life is a greater thing than staying here in most cases. So let's look what he says. Verse 21, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Think about that. To die is gain. It's better. Now watch. For if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. If I stay here, this is what I'm looking forward to. Chained, in prison, different things going forward. Yet, what I shall choose, I know not. You hear that? Now think about that. This is Paul, chained to Roman guards, and he says, if I stay here, this is what I got to look forward to. To die is gain. It'd be better to die. But yet, you know, I don't know yet which I'm going to choose, whether to stay here or whether to die. Now, think about that. He is choosing. Who's in control of this situation? Paul. You hear that? He's chained to Roman guards, and yet he says, I don't know if I'm going to choose what I'm going to do yet. I don't know. I'm not sure. Because I know it's to go. Man, I would love that because that'd be better. But he said, I don't know if I'm going to choose to go or not. He says, for I'm in a strait betwixt two. In other words, I'm really torn between the two choices, stay and be killed, martyred, or to, you know, to stay here, to here now, to be continuing helping the church, or to go on and be martyred and be with the Lord Jesus. He said, I really don't know which I've chosen. I hadn't made up my mind yet. Now, think about that. Now, I remember a while back I was on Facebook, and I really don't get on it much anymore. But I was on Facebook and I was preaching a little bit on it. And some lady wrote and said, what planet are you from? And I started talking with her a little bit back and forth. And she said, I've never heard anybody talk like that. And I said, well, you know, you ought to get out more. And you ought to get around more living Christians, you know. But because I was talking as one that was actually not under circumstances, but in charge of circumstances. And so, if the world understands you, you're not representing Christ well enough, right? Now, they understand what you're preaching, but they shouldn't understand how you live. They're looking at it and go, how do you do that? You know, I can tell you right now, we are to be called the Bumblebee Church. right? Because we are doing things, you know, they say it's technically impossible for a bumblebee to fly with the wings it's got. I don't know if that's scientific or not. I've always heard it and never checked it out. But that's us. We're doing things that we can't do. And that's exactly why God called us to do them, right? Do you realize normal people filled with the Spirit of God can do the impossible? Why? Because God is the God of the impossible. It has nothing to do with the normal people. You got that? So if you just say, well, you don't understand. I'm not like you. I'm not like this. I'm not like that person. I'm just normal. Great. Get a hold of an abnormal God. Amen. Right? Amen. Get a hold of a God that can do the impossible. And don't ever go back to thinking it was you that did it. Right? Always remember that part. Amen. And just know that it was God in you that's able to do the impossible. Amen. So he says here, I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart. I really want to go on to be with Christ, but which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. Lord, I really want to go. It would be so awesome to just be present with Christ. But you still need me, so I'll stick around here for a while. And the whole time he's preaching that, he's chained to Roman guards who, in their mind, they're going to take him back, take him to trial, and probably kill him. And we know that after this, he was actually released after this. And then later on was arrested again. And at that point, he even gave the words and said, you know, I'm ready. I'm ready to go. My life is poured out. I've run, what? I've run the race. And I've done what? I've finished my course. In other words, I've done everything I'm supposed to do. Now I'm ready to go. And we know that he wasn't, you know, 30 years old when that happened. Right? Because they called him Paul the Aged. Right? And so we know that he was an elder at that point. So he lived a good long life way after even some of these situations. He was probably born about the same time Jesus was, pretty close to that. And so you look at his life, by this time, by the time he was actually, executed, he had lived a good long life and preached the gospel for the majority of his life. But it was the whole point I'm trying to get across here is he made the choice. He was deciding, even though he was chained to Roman guards, he was choosing whether he stayed or whether he left. Listen, this is what I want to get across to you today. I want you to realize you're in far more control of your circumstances and your situations than you think you are. And the only reason you say, well, look at my circumstances, it doesn't look like I'm in charge of them. It's only because you have basically, you know, just abdicated your position. You've basically just said, well, I can't do anything about it. No, you can. You can decide to start agreeing with what the Word of God says about your life and what God has said in His Word about who you are and what you're here to do. Now, if you're here and you think your whole life is wrapped up in a job somewhere and you think that's the sum total of your life, then, yeah, the job pretty much dictates everything. Why? Because that's your God. But if you realize here that that job is just one way that God gets money to you, one way, if you make it the only way, guess what? You're at the mercy of the economy. But if you let God be in charge of your finances, that'll be one way. And if something happens with that way, he'll bring it another way. And if that way doesn't make enough, he'll bring in another way to make it enough. Amen? God is smart. He can let the world system pay you to get his work done. And so, but you have to start realizing, I'm in control of this thing. Why? Because God is in me and I'm here to represent him. I'm here to advance the kingdom. And he has given me power and authority to overcome these situations. So whatever comes against me in this situation, as I'm fulfilling the will of God, as far as I'm concerned, it's a devil, which means adversary. And it's something for me to put under my feet and to walk on. Amen? Amen? Amen. So, notice here, he says, verse 25, and having this confidence, right? Knowing these things, having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith. And where he just said, okay, you're right. And while I'm writing this, I've made up my mind. First, I wasn't sure. I really want to go, but for you, okay, I'll stay. I will just stay. I'm not going to die now. And he didn't. Now, look at Hebrews chapter 11. So now we've had Jesus, we've had the apostles, we've had the apostle Paul. Now let's look at Hebrews 11, verse 35. It says, women receive their dead raised to life again. Now, how did they do that? By faith. Hebrews 11 is all by faith. And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance. You hear that? Not accepting deliverance. Now, if they'd just left that part out, then we wouldn't have a whole lot to say about things like this. But notice it said here that they were tortured Why? Why were they tortured? Because they didn't accept deliverance. Now, you can't accept what isn't, you cannot not accept what isn't offered. So in other words, deliverance was offered to them and they chose not to accept deliverance. Why? Tells us right here. That they might obtain a better resurrection. As a martyr, they had also a martyr's crown. And so he said, so that they can get a better resurrection, they decided not to accept deliverance. In other words, they thought, right then, I guarantee you, angels were ready to deliver them. And the angels were fixing to probably make a move to set them free as they were being tortured. And yet they said, wait, no, hang on. Don't set me free yet. I'm looking forward to a better resurrection. I'm looking forward to a time where I can give Jesus more crowns. I can lay more crowns at his feet. If I go through this, it will bring honor to him that I didn't take the easy way out. But now, that easy way out was offered, or else it could not have been denied or forsaken. Do you get that? Now, this is just plain scripture. Notice verse 36. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, they were tempted, were slain with a sword, they wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. Now, look at God's opinion of them, of whom the world was not worthy. Think about that. You have a choice. You can make the choice to decide to be a person of whom the world is not worthy. That means you can live above the world's system. You can live according to God's system. And you can be classified as a person of whom the world is not worthy. Imagine that. God esteems people of faith to the degree where he says, you know what? The world doesn't even deserve you. The world doesn't even deserve you. Why? You're better than that. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. Now listen to this. Now, he says these people were people whom the world was not worthy. But God, having provided some better thing for us. So here's these great people. And it says that they without us should not be made perfect. So God brags on these people. And then Paul, apparently Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Paul says, yeah, God held these people in such high esteem. And yet without us, they couldn't be made perfect. Now, if he's talking about people that were held in that high esteem, what kind of esteem does God hold us in? You understand? Right. That's the position you are in Christ. If you ever, this, again, this comes out in the new man a lot, but if you ever find out who you truly are in Christ, your whole world will change. You'll start to walk with dignity. You'll start to live with dignity. You'll give other people dignity, and you'll start to reach out and touch lives and change lives, and you won't even consider the resources that you're going to do it with. Why? Because the resources will be there when you need it. Amen. Listen, that fish with that money in his mouth that Peter had to go get, that fish was just swimming around out there, and that fish was waiting to find out where Peter was going to walk up to the edge. Right? And wherever that, I guarantee that fish was 20 miles away. As soon as Peter started getting close to that bank of the sea there, I guarantee that fish was swimming as fast as he could to get there. Why? Because he had to be there. Right? He had to get there. That was that fish's purpose in life, was to bring that coin to Peter. You got that? So when you start walking that way, your destiny meets you wherever you're at. Well, what if I miss God? You can't miss God. He's too big. You understand? You can't miss God. He is too big for you to miss. He has a purpose and a destiny for your life. And we could look around here. This is a small building with a handful of people, but we are changing this city a piece at a time, and we're going to continue changing it. We're going to continue changing it. And as we move out into the things of God and we start doing the things that we can't do, then we're going to change the city even more. And my goal, which I firmly believe that this is a plan that God has put in my heart, my goal is that if and when it's necessary, and it looks like it could be before too long, that we will be able to do exactly what Amy Semple McPherson did with Angelus Temple in Los Angeles during the Great Depression. She and her church fed more people than the United States government did. It was amazing what she did with that church. And no matter where they were, if they picked up the phone and said, I'm over here and I'm hungry, within an hour, They had a team of people that would take food and clothing there to meet those people and be able to feed them and take care of them and even put them in a place. They used to sit and read through the newspapers when they had the, in the old days, they had births of babies in the, written in the newspaper. And many times they didn't have the name, but they would have it as a boy or a girl. And these women of the church would sit and read these birth reports. And as soon as one was born, they'd say, oh, this is a boy. And the women would start knitting a blanket for a boy, a blue blanket. And then they would find out where it was, and they would take food and the blanket and clothing to that family and take care of that mother until she was back up and moving around again. And all they did was read the newspaper. Didn't know these people. They weren't members of their church. Eventually probably did. But they said that they would just go out and help these people. It was like an army that was organized to take care of the people of the city, not just the people in the church. Amen? Amen. So, now let's give you some more here real quick. I'm trying to watch my time. We're doing okay though. In Luke chapter 10, this is the verse everybody ought to know. Starting in verse 17. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, look, see, take notice. I give unto you power, authority, to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the ability of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. You hear that? You've got to get that mind. This is Jesus talking. So this was the mind of Christ. And you are to let the mind of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. You get that? His mind. Now we have the mind of Christ. What was his mind? His mind was, guess what? This is not my appointed end. I'm not getting thrown off a cliff. I'm waiting for a cross. That was his mind. That needs to be your mind. This is not the end. This is not my end. My end will be glorious for Jesus. Right? My end is not to go out in the corner somewhere. My end is to go out big. Why? To bring glory to Jesus. Amen? You got that? Amen. And until CNN and Fox and MSNBC and all those others, until they are ready to cover my death, I ain't ready to go nowhere. You understand? Yeah, go ahead and laugh. You watch. That's why I ain't going nowhere. They're not ready to cover it yet. Right? So, but it has to be glorious for the kingdom. Yeah. Amen? Do you get that? Yeah. But you have to... faith is not an attitude, but it creates an attitude. And you start to live this way, and you start to realize, you know what? What I say will come to pass. Why? Because I'm with him. Amen? And he won't let one of my words fall to the ground. What does that mean? I've got to watch my words. I've got to make sure what I speak, I want to come to pass. He goes on and says, notwithstanding in this rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Let's just give you another quick one. Everybody knows Psalm 91. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Oh God, where are you? No, that's not what it says. Oh, why is God letting this happen to me? Why is this happening to me? Maybe it's because you're not saying of the Lord. He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wing shall you trust. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You will not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day. Do you hear that? You're not going to be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. In other words, all these things coming on the world ain't going to touch me. He says, 1,000 shall fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Amen. Now see, listen, the world is there to try to get you to change this, to say, well, it's the flu season. Got to catch the flu. You got to. Why? Because you're like everybody else. No, I'm not. I'm not like everybody else. I might watch 1,000 fall at my side and 10,000 by my right hand, but it won't touch me. Why? Because I will say of the Lord, he is my shield. He is my buckler. I will say of the Lord, he is my fortress. Amen? Amen? Amen. You've got to start to see this. Listen, this isn't enough for me to live this, and people look at me and go, look at his life. He's living a good life. You know, why didn't he get sick when everybody else? You know, every time I get sick, he's not sick. Why don't he get sick? No, you got to believe this. You start believing this, you start saying this, and listen, whatever you believe, you will start saying. And when you start saying and start believing and start living out, you'll start seeing it in your life, and you'll become an example that people look at you and go, man, I just wish I was as blessed as him. You know, I guess God loves him more than me. No, he doesn't. The difference is, I may love the Word more than you. You start loving the Word, and the Word starts working in you. Amen. You got to fall in love with the Word of God and find out what it has said, and let it start living through you. And you'll start developing that what Dr. Summerall used to call the spirit of command, a commanding spirit. And I mean, just being around him just made the difference in my life, watching how he functioned. But you've got to develop that. It's not enough for you to say, well, I just know if I get sick, I know where I can go. That ain't good enough. You've got to be the light. You've got to be the light in your area where people can say about you, I know if I get sick, I know where I can go. And it'll be you they go to and not you having to bring them to me. Amen? Amen. So he says, only, verse 8, only with your eyes shall you behold and see the reward of the wicked. Only with your eyes. You won't receive it. You won't have it. It won't touch you. You'll see it, but it won't touch you. Because you have made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, your habitation. Not your visitation. You don't go to visit God at church, but you live with him. Amen. And it says if you live with him, then you'll see it, but it won't touch you. What does that mean? It means if it's touching you, you're not living with God, you're visiting him. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come near your dwelling. You hear that? When that plague starts to come up to your doorstep, it needs to stop and look. Oh, I'm sorry. I see the blood over the door. Can't go in there. Sorry, can't go in there. And if it starts to try to come forward, you say, oh, no, you don't. No, you don't. And you chase it right back out to the street. You tell it, this is a refuge. This is a safe place. You can come here, and I don't care if you come in here sick, you leave well. Right? Because sickness and disease can't live here. Verse 11, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. You realize this is the scripture Jesus used to beat the devil when the devil tried to get him to commit suicide? They shall bear thee up in your hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet, because he hath set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Now, do you realize what we hear in the church today, and it's a good thing, but I'll just throw this out at you. What we hear in the church today, everything is about the love of the Father. The Father's heart. Loving the Father, love God, let him love you. He loves you. You love him. It's a good thing. I'm not putting it down. But you realize that's only half the truth. And what that does is it tells people how much God loves you. But Jesus told the Pharisees, he said, you always err not knowing the Word of God and the power of God. Not knowing the Scriptures and the power of God. People are saying, is it Scripture? Is it the Word of God that the Father loves you and you're to love Him? Yes, absolutely. But if that's all you know, you err not knowing the power of God. Here he says, he will deliver you because you love Him. You've set your love upon Him. And yet that's what the majority of the church is doing. We're setting our love upon God, but we're not realizing, yes, I love you. And most of the church is saying, I love you while they die. Rather than saying, I love you, and because I've set my love on you, you will deliver me. You will keep me. I will see these things, but they will not touch me. The things will happen to those around me, but they're not going to happen to me. Do you see that? So we have to move beyond just knowing the love of God. The love of God is awesome. Because of the love of God, we are in command. We are in positions of authority over sickness and disease because of that. You understand? It's not either or. Well, you know, it's love or power. No, it's not. It's both together. And if you truly understand the love of God, you'll walk in his power. Now, finishing up, 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. Let's read these quick. Verse 18. Now let's get down to you. Okay? Here's how to become untouchable. First step, believe. Okay? Believe. You have to believe you're untouchable. Well, you say, well, where's the scripture? Let me give you one. 1 John 5:18. We know, not we think, not we hope. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself. Who keeps him? He keeps himself. All right. And that wicked one toucheth him not. You hear that? You keep yourself and the wicked one touches you not. This is a full-on promise that if you will keep yourself, and you say, what does it mean keep yourself? I'll show you that in just a second. But you keep yourself in the love of God, technically, is what it's talking about. But as you keep yourself, the wicked one touches you not. Think about that. I'm telling you, it is good to know that you are right with God, that there's nothing in there that the enemy can come and pull on it sometime and go, oh, remember this? Let's do this. But that you're clean before God, that he has justified you, regenerated you. I'm using all these big religious terms. And even sanctified. I almost taught on sanctification this morning. I came real close. But we'll save that. But sanctification just means separated from one thing to something else. Usually separated from the world and separated unto God. And that sanctification, that separation, it is once you have received that cleansing to know that you're right with God, then you can stand, and it's a great feeling to be able to stand and be able to say, you know what, devil, take your best shot because you can't touch me. Why? Because there ain't nothing in me. That's what Jesus said. The wicked one comes and has nothing in me. You hear that? That's where you stand when you're right with God. The wicked one can come. He looks at you. He looks for a place that he can get an advantage. He looks for an open door somewhere, and there's none. Why? Because the Lord is your shield. The Lord is your buckler. That's your shield and your armor. The Lord is that to you. That's who he is. And you say, you know what? Devil, take your best shot because you can't touch me. And you say, I'm right with God. I'm right with man. I'm right, and right now the devil has nothing in me. I'm clean. And the devil can do nothing. You get that? That's a good feeling. And then, whenever you know that, you have no problem wading out in the middle of, you know, several hundred people that have HIV and every other type of contagious disease, and you just wander out there and start laying hands on them because you know what? You can touch them, but that sickness can't touch you. Why? Because you live in divine health. Why? Because you live in the love of God. And you start to walk in this, and you start to look at these things, and the people you can't touch, you can go, you're free in Jesus' name. And that thing has to die in them. That's the life that Jesus meant for you to live. Amen? This is not some high pinnacle for you to achieve. You were made righteous. You were placed there. It isn't that you attained there. You were placed there, and while you live there, you learn every day how to live it better and better, and that's called sanctification. When you learn how to live free of these things every day on an ongoing basis, and you further and further separate yourself from the ways of the world, not from the world. See, that's been the problem. The church has separated itself from the world, and it doesn't even touch the world. It ends up being a little social club where you come together. And all you do is talk about you being blessed. But instead, you become the church and you start being the people that can go out and touch people that need help without fear of that thing jumping on you. Worst thing I hear among Christians now is, he went into a bar to witness. Oh, he shouldn't have gone there. Well, he shouldn't go there only if he's afraid of going in there and falling prey to getting drunk. Right? But the Salvation Army would get people saved and they would go in and get prostitutes saved, and in 2 weeks the prostitutes were right back at the prostitution houses and preaching to this, and they weren't afraid of falling back into that lifestyle. Why? Because they really got saved. When you really get saved, sin is a hateful thing because you realize the cost. It's not something you play with. Well, you know, I can sin and get away with it. You don't want to get away with it. You're like Christ in the Spirit, and you hate sin. You hate evil, and you love that which is good. Amen? So, that's the first one. Wicked one touches them not. Jude 24 and 25. Jude only has one chapter, so it's not chapter 24, verse 25. It's verses 24 and 25. Now listen to this. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Hear that? You can be kept from falling. Well, you know, we all fall every now and then. No. You, listen, nobody falls into sin. You walk into it. Yeah, it's not like you're walking along and you trip and fell in sin. You know, you're walking along, fell into bed with somebody. No, that don't happen. You walk in there, okay? Every button you unbutton is a choice you're making. Do you understand that? You don't have to sin. The power of sin has been broken. It's a choice. See? And so you have to make that decision. You don't fall into sin, right? You walk into it. In your job, now, born of Christ, the Spirit of God in you makes you not want to do that. It makes you look at it differently, and you want to help other people be free of it because it's a good thing to be free.
Amen?
Amen? It's a good thing to have only one Lord,
amen,
right? And not to have a bunch of lords, you know, money and sex and, you know, food and you name it, anything. Anything can be a lord over if you let it, right? Unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of God. You get that? To present you faultless before the presence of his glory in exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Now, 2 Peter chapter 1, last one. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Simon Peter says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Grace, peace, be multiplied unto you. How? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath, past tense, given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. You hear that? There's not one thing you need. There's just the ability to access that thing is the only thing you need. You need to know how to access it. Everything you need has been given. The people don't live in that. It's just because they don't know how to access it. And you access it through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ. And you start to access it through faith and start to walk it out. Through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. You hear that? If you have God's nature, if you have the Spirit of Christ, if you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you're none of his. If you have the Spirit of Christ and you have God's nature, and you have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, you're not participating in it, and it doesn't touch you. You get that? You have escaped it. And besides this, now watch, I'm going to show you why this is important. Giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge, and to knowledge, temperance. You see these steps? You see this building. And to temperance, patience, and to patience, godliness. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So if these things, listen, if you are barren or unfruitful in the things of God in your life, it is because you have not added these things into your life. You say, Corey, you're talking about I have to do these things to get that, and you're talking about works. No, I'm talking about you after being saved, you're working out your salvation with fear and trembling. You get that? You're not working for your salvation, you're working out your salvation. But he that lacks these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and has forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if we do these things, you shall never fall. You hear that? Now, that right there tells us, and that's it. That's the last verse I'm giving you. But these things tell you how you can be protected, how the enemy cannot touch you and you ought to live in that place, how you can live in a place where you will never be unfruitful or unbarren or barren in the things of God, that everything you put your hand to will be blessed, that it will prosper, that everything that you start to reach out into and start to do will be fruitful and come to a fruition in your life, that you never have to suffer unnecessarily, you understand that? And that you will never have to fall. Think about that. Years ago when I was in Sulphur, Louisiana, we were helping start a church and doing street ministry. And I kept listening to a song, Keith Green Music. I was raised up on it, Christian-wise, great stuff, a lot of good stuff. We need more singers like that, people that sing not just with their head, but with their heart. And he kept, but he, there was, and I'm not saying all his stuff was right, okay? I don't agree with all of his theology, but it was good. It kept me from a lot of the excesses, okay? And I remember I was listening to this one song over and over again, and I don't know why I did it, but it was called, actually one of the words in it is, I don't want to fall away from you. And I was singing that, and I was saying, I meant it from my heart. God, I don't want to fall away from you. But I kept focusing on that, falling away from him. And I started noticing, even as I was singing that and doing everything else, it was like there was a distancing between me and God. That it was like I was falling away. And I started realizing, and then having read Charles Finney and some of his stuff, I realized what you focus on, you become. And whatever you focus on, you will create the emotion for. And so that's why so many preachers that preach so hard against sin end up in sin. Why? Because that's all they focus on. Now, you need to warn people of sin, but you don't need to live there. Right? And so you need to let people know about it, but at the same time, it doesn't say an awareness of sin is what brings people to repentance. It's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. So yeah, you need to warn, but you also need to be able to tell people this is the goodness of God, that you don't have to live there. That you can live free of that. But we need to be able to talk about these things, and we need to start talking amongst ourselves. Listen, this can't be just preaching. This has to be how we talk. Even on this last road trip, we were moving in this direction, and I was trying to get across over and over again. Listen, this is how we live. We talk victory constantly. Even when we hit a problem, guess what? We talk victory in the problem, and the problem will dissipate. Right? We will overcome it. You're overcoming it by destroying it, all right? But you talk victory, and you begin, and whenever people around you, if they love you and you love them, and they correct you because you say something, that's not a bad thing, it's a good thing. But eventually, and I'm not talking about you going around picking people apart either, I'm saying that you start to remind people, you know, oh, my feet's killing me. Come on, really? Really? Your feet's killing you, all right? Well, when you drop over, I'll raise you up, all right? So that's just... You know, and you kind of make it a joke, but go, oh yeah, I shouldn't have said it that way. Why? Because your feet ain't killing you. That's a lie, right? Well, you know, what it is your feet are what? Beautiful. Why? Because you bring the gospel of peace. Amen. Isn't that right? So that's why instead of saying, my feet's killing me. No, my feet are beautiful. Right? They bring peace. Amen? Not pain, peace. And you start to live on top of these things. Amen? Amen. So now, do you believe that you can live above sin? You don't have to fall, right? You don't have to choose to go into sin. You choose to stay out of sin, amen? That by understanding and putting these things into your life, that you can always be fruitful, never be barren in the things of God, amen? Think about that. Everything you put your hand to comes to pass. That's awesome, right? Amen. Think about it. You'll start looking for places to invest, right? You know, hey, I can get involved in this thing and it'll prosper. Oh, don't get involved in that. That thing's going down. Oh, no, it's going up. Why? Because I'm involved, right? See, the biggest problem with the Titanic is I wasn't on it. That's it. Now, because it was still, how did it float with that big old hole? It's a miracle. Yeah, okay, anyway. So, do you believe you can live above these things, that you're supposed to be in control over these things? With God in your life, you're doing the impossible. What the world can't do, we should be able to do. Amen? Amen. That's all, stand up. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge.
He is my strength.
And I am strong.
I can do the impossible.
Because I can see the invisible.
And my God
is more powerful in me
than anything I can face.
And together,
we overcome.
In the name of Jesus.
Sickness and disease
cannot live in my body.
Life lives in my body.
And I have so much life
that I have enough for me to stay well
and enough to give away to make somebody else well.
And that's called life in abundance.
And right now,
sickness and disease
has to flee
because I have submitted myself
under the hand of God.
I resist the devil.
And he flees.
And he flees quickly.
And I am delivered.
I'm free.
I'm healthy. I'm strong.
I'm prosperous.
I'm a blessing.
I'm looking for people
that I can bless.
And I share
the words of life.
And my words
are spirit.
And they are life.
Because I've made his words
my words.
And I will say
what is good,
what is right,
what is pure,
what is lovely.
I will say all these things
because that's what I think about.
And what I think about
comes out of my mouth.
Because that's the abundance of my heart.
So right now, Father,
we praise you.
We glorify you.
That we did not have to attain this position,
but you have made us
to be inheritors.
Father, we thank you
that you
are our inheritance
and that we are yours.
And Father, you said
that if we open our mouths wide,
you will fill them.
And Father, you said
that we can have what we say.
And you said
that you have given us
the heathen
for our inheritance.
And we thank you.
And right now,
we call in
the people
from the north,
the south,
the east,
and the west.
And we say,
come
just as you are.
And God will not leave you that way.
But he will recreate you.
And right now,
in the name of Jesus,
we call forth
laborers
to help us
in the Lord's vineyard,
to help us
in this great harvest
of the souls,
spirits,
and bodies.
And we thank you, Father,
that we are more than able
to do whatever is put before us.
Because we have you within us.
And because of that,
we will save the lost.
We'll heal the sick.
We'll raise the dead.
We will cast out devils.
We will feed the hungry.
We will clothe the naked.
We will rescue those that are trapped.
And Father, we thank you
that you open our eyes
and our hearts
and our hands
to be instruments
used of you
to change this nation
in Jesus' name.
Amen.